Yes, thank you for this question. And historically, it was like that. My house is not far from here. I'm biking to my department, which is in this direction. And when I was biking near this place, I've seen a strange situation. Some people from New Guinea, and they looked like people from New Guinea, and some people from Stanford Art Department were working together. They would be sitting on the big piece of tree, and at some point, this big piece of tree becomes one of the sculptures. And it was amazing because day after day, they were making progress. And eventually they made this garden. And many, many people here at Stanford like to come here. It is such an unusual and place where it is nice to sit and think and look around and think, what does all of this mean in the big picture of things? This is why we like this place, and I suggested that we may as well do this film here. Yes, sometimes, yeah, because it is also on my way, so I can always stop here when I am biking and decide to look, because they change sometimes. They change lighting, they add new descriptions. Art department at Stanford keeps updating. And also you can always see some people here wandering and surprised and charmed by the place. Maybe when I was a student in Moscow at physics department, and I became interested in theoretical physics somewhere in the middle of my students' years, and then it became my passion. I still view it as something I like very much, because there were many, many interesting developments, both on theoretical as well as on experimental side. I think I had the encouragement from my teachers in math and in physics. They clearly gave me to understand that I should pursue this direction. I was doing well comparative, and this was a little bit difficult because they were mostly young men in physics at that time, but this is changing now. There are many young women who aspire and do well in theoretical physics. Yes, we went to CERN.
Yes.
We spent 2 years there. And then we had an offer from different places, and one of them was Stanford campus. And we really liked this place, both intellectually because of people doing physics here, as well as we just liked it here. This garden was not there, but there are many other spots as beautiful. For example, there is cactus garden, there is a Rodin sculpture garden, and there is a palm drive, which is one of the very beautiful, I don't know if you've seen it, palm drive.
Well, we were yesterday on a drive, I'm not sure if that's the palm, it was the scenic drive.
From Stanford Church, you can see, and you can see the downtown Palo Alto, and this is also very nice. And there is huge amount of eucalyptus tree all over, and there is enough, you know, it's not quite southern, so people are not lazy. People are working hard, but there is also a beauty of nature here, which is very inspirational. Oh, it was extremely difficult. In fact, I was not allowed to do it for a very long time. And at some point, it was Steve Hawking, a very famous British physicist, who invited me to Cambridge. And authorities in Moscow were so surprised, and they suddenly helped me to go to a conference in Cambridge. And then after that, after the Deus and Machina Steve Hawking intervention, I was able to travel. Oh yes, yeah. There were a number of conferences which he organized, and we had a lot of collaboration and discussion of things, and yes, very much. Unfortunately, now he is not in best shape, of course, but. I think it encouraged me enormously when I was young, yeah. And we had recently some conference which he organized in Cambridge, dedicated to all those things which we started earlier, and it was really very nice.
Yeah.
It was wonderful that he gave me this support early in my career. Well, one of the great discoveries about 100 years ago, as you know, was general relativity by Einstein. And many people who are not in physics, they may not even know that smartphones and GPS work with this precision which we need because of general relativity. On the other hand, we have quantum mechanics, which is also almost 100 years old. And again, people may know or not know that lasers and CD discs and all kind of devices they're easily using today are because 100 years ago, physicists made discoveries. So general relativity on one side and quantum mechanics on the other side are each most beautiful, greatest discoveries. However, they don't work well together. Unfortunately, what we don't know how to build quantum gravity, where we combine Einstein's theory of general relativity with quantum mechanics. String theory is one of the most serious attempts to solve the problem of quantum gravity, which means to combine general relativity, Einstein's theory, with quantum mechanics. As of now, there is no better proposal. And string theory is a complicated theory. So what we try to do, we try to use those experiments available to us, which helps us in this direction. And one of them is the recent Planck satellite, which was launched by ESA, European agency. And it just started releasing the data this March. Those data concern the early universe and how it was created. And here is the case which we want to analyze, what exactly we have received from the cosmological observations and how it affects our understanding of the fundamental theory. Under fundamental theory we mean attempt to combine general relativity with quantum mechanics. And the reason we involve early universe into this, because we have data with huge precision now that we are looking at the sky, and we found various new information which was not available just very recently. For example, we know for 10 years that the universe right now accelerates, and this leads to the mystery of dark energy, which we are trying to understand from the perspective of fundamental physics. And the only reasonable way to address this problem, which we know, is from the perspective of string theory, which allows some very unusual outcome and which tells us that maybe we live in the multiverse, not in the universe. And this is rather interesting and very unusual, but we have the data and they seem to be improving. They're not going away. So theoretical physicists are trying to understand the current data from the sky, from cosmology, as well as from LHC, from the collider at CERN, combine them and decide what it tells us together about fundamental physics. And this is where I am involved and many of my colleagues. And part of this is what string theory tells us about the situation, how we can explain the data from this perspective and how those two things would eventually help us to solve the problem of quantum gravity. What happened in March when Planck released the data, they were saying the universe is almost perfect. That is a statement from people who analyze the Planck data. What means almost perfect? This is what we are trying to understand, because it turns out much simpler than expected. But this almost is not yet clear to us, and it will be difficult for me to give you a definite answer how soon we expect the resolution of the puzzle which is with us for last 100 years. I would not dare to make evaluation how long it will take. I would only say it is extremely interesting, and theorists are very grateful to people who do the observations because they help, and eventually we will be there. Sure, it may be not enough. Because it will be, you know, it's difficult to predict, but we certainly see accumulation of new information coming on both sides, on the experimental as well as on theoretical. And the process is very interesting. And the scale, when we will know, I don't know. It remains to be seen. I think you are right. Especially at Stanford, as you see, the way the sky is blue today, it is like that except a short time in winter. So we do see stars very well. And yes, walks here bring inspiration. And yes, it is a nice environment which leads to nice developments. And yes, looking at this, at the sky in the evening is really nice. Just walk around here, you'll see it. I think there are many distinguished physicists who are extremely good at giving public talks, and they do it. And for example, for people who are not in physics community, it may still be extremely interesting to know that the discovery of current acceleration of the universe allows us to speculate about the future of the universe. I think everybody would be interested to know about it. And so there are many people who give public talks in physics exactly about this topic. And for example, also about the multiverse, whether it is universe or multiverse, this is where theoretical physics becomes close to philosophy and to interest of everybody who has any intellectual, you know, curiosity. And theoretical physics at this point, when we try to interpret cosmology with regard to theoretical physics, becomes so close to philosophy and generic intellectual, you know, curiosity of mankind. So best physicists try to give these public talks and make public aware of the current progress in physics. It was in the context of multiverse we have found that philosophers become extremely curious. And I'm not the person who often does it, but it was this multiverse aspect of my work which I noticed was interesting, not just to physicists, but in particular to philosophers. And they were trying to understand why now? Why now we are talking about the multiverse? And so I was able to explain what it has to do with the current discovery of acceleration of the universe. It was not known before. And it enforced this new way of thinking, which may affect not just physicists. So the hope and the expectation is that we will be able to explain the universe at large and the universe at small. So all experiments like LHC, the high energy accelerator of particle physics, they deal with extremely small distances, like 10 to the minus 16 centimeters, whereas the universe is 10 to the 28 centimeters. The difference is huge. And the hope is that there is just one universe, which includes small and big, and this fundamental theory, which we are looking forward, in case of particle physics, definitely requires quantum theory. This is what we know for sure. In terms of everything we know by making observation on the sky, Einstein theory was always perfect. And it is just that they don't work together. We have lots of inconsistencies at the mathematical level. And therefore, we do not seem to have, at present, a theory, the theory, But if we will have it, maybe it will be one theory explaining huge universe and universe at small. And this is where quantum mechanics, we know, have to work at small distances. And at large distances, we know Einstein theory as well is working well. So this is what is now the goal, to somehow combine them. That's a beautiful question, I love it. You know, one of the rare occasions when the fact that I am teaching at Stanford, I teach graduate classes, and I had to teach classical mechanics. This is a very old subject, and so I start looking into modern developments, which has to do with dynamical systems. I decided to update the story, and then I learned that this dynamical system, they explained all kinds of phenomena in economy, heartbeats, in medicine, in finances, in all kinds of nonlinear systems, including classical mechanics. This is more neoclassical mechanics. So I started implementing it into my class, and suddenly I noticed that in my personal research, and I was doing supersymmetric black holes, there is one of the most important features of all these dynamical systems, means attractor behavior. This is when the system forgets the initial condition and goes into the situation which is generic, independently of where it started. This is what stabilizes heartbeats. So something happened, but then you have again a regular heartbeat, no matter what happened. Small deviation didn't change it. And then I have realized that in the story on which I was working, which has to do with supersymmetry, LHC and everything, and black holes, which I learned a lot from Steve Hawking, there is this attractor mechanism. And this is thing which was done a long time ago. There were many, many papers afterwards, and people still find inspiration in this. And yes, it is the universality of dynamical systems which enforces that when they work in analogous ways, like I started telling you, in finances, in biology, in economy, in physics, in many situations. So my reason was just trying to improve the intellectual quality of my teaching. Surprising reason, but it's true. This is how it happened.
So it's kind of a coincidence.
Yeah, it was a nice coincidence, which I always give to people as an one explanation why teaching actually enforces on you to think out of the box. You just think differently, and this is good.
Yeah, well, you have to be able to think out of the box.
Right, and be motivated to do something new. And then you find that there is something new for you.
Yeah.
Well, this is the problem. You have to take your time away from research, and it makes you less competitive. On the other hand, just the example which I gave you is good enough, because then there were hundreds of people doing this after me, so I didn't suffer because of that. And Stanford students are extremely good, so teaching them is often overcoming the fact that you have to take your time from research. And it is nice to be here anyway and see young faces, see satisfaction on their faces. It's a really nice part of Stanford.
Amongst physicians?
Oh yeah, of course. There is a lot of competition. People have ambitions. And once you send your paper 2 weeks later or 1 day later, you lost it. Maybe you were working half a year on a project, and the project is mature. At that time, somebody else was working in the world. And you lost it if you are late for 10 days or 1 day. And this is why I mentioned that sometimes teaching, decent teaching, requires a lot of time. So then you have to push your research a little bit down. But then you have all the competitors, but that's life. It's fair, it is always fair, yeah. So people try not to delay too much their new results because they know there is a competition, yes. Well, I have many friends on campus. Professor Eric Bergshoff.
Yes, I visit him.
Professor Diederik Roost. Eric will be here on Monday, starting Monday, and Diederik is coming on September 23. They're my good friends and my collaborators, and I was there, and anytime when I'm in Holland, in particular in Groningen, or when they are coming here, we're happy to work together. We share our intellectual views. We met with Eric when we both were fellows at CERN. And then I went here and he went to Groningen. So we have a long history and long collaboration, and I love this part. This is wonderful to have. So I have warmest feelings towards Groningen and my very, very best wishes. So the most interesting part of the story, which has to do with Planck data, which were released this spring, is the following. They're looking at the sky, which means they're looking back in time. 13.7 billion of years is the total age of the universe, approximately. And they are looking at the very early universe. And what they see now and what they told us this March, in their own words, they told us the universe is almost perfect. What does it mean? It means here's the map of the universe given by Planck, and you can show it. And here is what it tells. There are thousands and thousands of different spots. Some of them are red, some of them are blue. And they perform analysis of correlation between those thousands and thousands of spots. And the conclusion is the universe is almost perfect. This is a huge gift to theorists who are trying to understand why. And this is where we are. And this is really something which, thanks to current technology, the people who sent the satellite were able to accomplish, and the turn of theorists is now to interpret it and understand better.